And a very warm welcome to you all to this, the first lecture in our series, Cambridge Vertical Readings in Dante's Comedy. Helen and I would like to start by thanking the Master and Fellows of Trinity College for hosting and the University of Cambridge Italian Department for generously sponsoring the first year of this new Lectura Dante's series. Dante's comedy consists of 100 cantos of between 115 and 160 lines, which are tightly knitted together in the terza rima, A, B, A, B, C, D, C, D, oh, A, B, A, B, A, B, A, B, C, D, C, D, C, rhyme scheme. T.S. Eliot considered that we can get as much out of one episode of one canto by Dante as from the reading of a single whole Shakespeare play. You may or may not agree with that. Since Dante's death in 1321, the popularity of the comedy has provoked the demand for public lectures on and readings of all of the 100 cantos. Boccaccio, who coined the term the divine comedy, la divina commedia, was one of the writers who inaugurated the Lectura Dante's tradition, a tradition which continues to flourish today around the world. There are now literally thousands of letturae, individual treatments of each of the 100 cantos. Over the coming four academic years, a team of expert Dante scholars will interpret all of the 100 cantos of the comedy, contributing to this long and interpretively rich Lectura Dante's tradition. However, they will do so from a new perspective, breaking out of the usual canto-by-canto Lectura format. Dante's comedy is one unified poem, but it falls into three distinct parts, or cantiche, canticles, the Inferno, the Purgatorio, and the Paradiso. The poem tells the story of Dante's journey during the Easter weekend, the year 1300, through these three regions of the Christian afterlife, hell, purgatory, and paradise. In our vertical reading series, scholars will explore the thematic and structural correspondences between cantos of the same number in each of the three canticles, and, at a narrative level, between the three paths through hell, purgatory, and paradise in the one journey. So this evening, we are going to explore the correspondence in Inferno 1, Purgatorio 1, Paradiso 1, and then the next section, Inferno 2, Purgatorio 2, Paradiso 2, and so on.
So we're calling them vertical readings in order to allude to a visual tradition of Dante's time. The mosaics, if you think of the baptistry of San Giovanni, or you think of some of Giotto's frescoes, can be read in both horizontal and vertical bands. And the vertical bands tend to reveal something like typological relationships between events. So while scholars have for some time been suggesting that there are important correspondences between canticles that beg to be explored, this is the first time that the approach will be pursued in a systematic fashion. So by means of this collaborative work, we're hoping that lectures will unlock an engaging new way to enter the core concerns of the poem, things like the political engagement of the sixes or the visions of generation in the 25s. So in this academic year, 2012 to 2013, our eight lectures will examine in parallel Dante's depiction of lower hell, that's Inferno 1 through 8, anti-purgatory, that's Purgatorio 1 through 8, and the lower three heavens, which are 1 through 8. This evening, we're going to introduce some parallels between the first canto of each of the canticles. In the first part of our lecture, The Pagan Dawn of a Christian Vision, we will explore Dante's appeal to the pagan and classical thought in the opening of each of the three paths through hell, purgatory, and paradise. And in the second, orientation and disorientation, we will investigate the challenges of locating and finding that path and the ways in which these challenges determine our experience of reading the comedy.
And just one further thing before we begin, we've been requested by the college to announce to participants that this lecture is being videoed. That's a formality that I was asked by the college to announce that. Okay, so Pagan Dawn of a Christian Vision. Each of the three cantos, Inferno 1, Purgatorio 1, Paradiso 1, begins with an attempted journey which ends in failure. In Inferno 1, Dante gazes up at the sun's rays which light up the mountain he then attempts to climb. Impeded by the three beasts and unable to defeat the she-wolf, who's been toppled by the she-wolf in that illustration, Dante returns to the wood from whence he came, where the sun is silent. In Purgatorio 1, this is a Botticelli illustration, the pre-dawn rise of the planet Venus, lo bel pianeta, inspires Dante, who has left behind the cruel sea, and the cruel sea is both the matter of the Inferno, which is about evil, and literally the sea which surrounds the shore of Mount Purgatory. So Dante leaves that behind, but interrogated by Cato's at the left side of the screen, he is sent back to the shore where he is washed and girded with a rush by Virgil. In Paradiso 1, Dante attempts to fix his eyes on the sun, but he has to give up after a short while. On an allegorical reading of the poem, the sun primarily represents God, and movement upwards represents movement towards God. These three attempts and failures are, therefore, three attempts and initial failures to journey towards God. What is striking, then, is that on each of these three occasions, when Dante initially fails in his journey to God, he is helped not, as we might expect in a Christian poem depicting the three realms of the Christian afterlife, by an angel or a saint or a passage of scripture, but rather by a pagan or by distinctively classical philosophy. The pagan poet-philosopher Virgil, at the left of the screen, comes to Dante's rescue in the dark wood in Inferno 1 and undertakes to be his guide through hell. Even more surprisingly, in the opening of Purgatorio, Dante is instructed by Virgil to kneel before Pedro Utica, a Roman pagan who committed suicide and yet acts as the gatekeeper of the shores of Mount Purgatory. And in Paradiso 1, when Dante, unable to continue fixing his eyes on the sun, turns to Beatrice, she responds with a discourse on the order of the world, which would have been as acceptable to the pagan philosopher Aristotle as to a medieval Christian theologian. Why Dante's emphasis on pagans at the beginning of a Christian poem depicting the three realms of the Christian afterlife, hell, purgatory, and paradise? Why Dante's recourse to natural ethics and natural philosophy when the poem is ostensibly about a Christian's journey to God? Let us consider in more detail the appeal to the pagan at the beginning of each cantica. Mentre che io rivenava in basso loco, dinanzi agli occhi, mi si fu aperto chi per lungo silenzio parea fioco. Quando vidi costui nel gran deserto, miserere di me, gridai a lui, qual che tu sii, od ombra od omo certo. In the penultimate canto of the comedy, Dante refers to King David, the author of the Psalms, as the singer who, grieving at his sin, said, miserere me. Dante Pilgrim is, like King David, a sinner turned singer. And his first words of the poem, in a strange conflation of the Vulgate Latin miserere and the vernacular Italian di me, echo the opening of King David's penitential psalm. And yet, peculiarly, Dante's addressee is not God, but he who, through long silence, seemed hoarse. This circumlocution is puzzling because, at a literal level, it does not seem possible that a person, although silent, may appear hoarse. We could only discover this when they begin to speak. A traditional interpretation, therefore, is that the interlocutor, as yet unidentified, initially represents the voice of reason. Reason, the divine, God-given part in man, is silent in the pilgrim immersed in the wood or valley of sin. Even when the voice of reason returns, it is inevitably weak and may only gather strength and clarity as the pilgrim struggles against the pull of sin. Dante Pilgrim does appeal in this way to his reason at this stage in the narrative. Why a pagan? Well, first of all, the choice of a pagan guide enables Dante to represent, if only at an allegorical level, human reason unaided by grace. Dante was convinced that man could pursue the natural good and be directed away from evil through the correct use of his reason. When, in Inferno 11, Dante Pilgrim asks Virgil about the ordering of evil in hell, Virgil refers primarily not to scripture, but to natural philosophy, and specifically to two canonical works by Aristotle, which he names, the Ethics and the Physics. By choosing a pagan as his guide, Dante makes a polemical point about reason, that reason is sufficient without Christian revelation to provide a theoretical basis, the natural law, for the ordering of good and evil in the temporal sphere. Virgil does not simply, however, represent reason or human wisdom. If Dante had simply wanted to allegorize philosophy, he could have chosen even more appropriately Aristotle, whom he calls il maestro di color che sano, the maximum authority in philosophy. We must not only ask, therefore, why a pagan guide, but why specifically the pagan guide Virgil? Dante establishes from Virgil's very first words in the poem that he is, first and foremost, a human soul who literally exists in the afterlife, although temporarily deprived of his body until the final judgment. Risposemi, non ho momo già fui, e li parenti miei furon lombardi, mantuani per patriam vedui. Nacqui sub Iulio, ancor che fosse tardi, e vissi a Roma sotto il buon Augusto, nel tempo degli dei falsi e ingianti. Poeta fui e cantai di quel giusto figlio de Anchisse che venne di Troia poi che il superbo Ilion fu combusto. Temporally, Dante massages the historical facts in order to make Virgil's life span the birth pangs of imperial Rome, from Caesar sub Iulio to his nephew Augustus, il buon Augusto. Geographically, Virgil locates his life in Rome, vissi a Roma. Vocationally, Virgil identifies himself as the poet of Roman Empire, cantai di quel giusto figlio di Anchisse. Why specifically the pagan Virgil? Because Virgil lived in Rome at the time of Augustus, and because Dante treats Virgil's Aeneid as if it were the Bible of imperial power. When Dante, in his prose work, The Convivio, argues that the Roman Empire was established by divine providence rather than by brute force, he defends this heterodox view with the authority of Virgil's Aeneid. His ego nec metas rem nec tempora ono, imperium sine fine dei, a costoro, and Dante emphasizes, cioè ali Romani, I set neither boundary, ne termine cose ne di tempo pongo, a loro ho dato imperio senza fine. Notably, Dante does not write that Virgil speaks in the person of Jupiter, but simply in the person of God, in persona di Dio parlando. Dante thus gives divine, quasi-scriptural authority to Virgil's text, and bolstered by it, he affirms that God gave divine jurisdiction to the Roman Empire. How does this emphasis on Virgil as poet of imperial Rome connect with the sense of Virgil as the embodiment of human reason, human wisdom? Dante believed that the pagan Aristotle had set out for all time the theory necessary for human flourishing, ethics, and for justice, the natural law. However, he also realized that such theory is impotent without political power. Dante considered then that the Roman Empire was ordained by God to implement the natural law and to establish universal peace and justice. Dante's choice of Virgil as guide, therefore, forms part of a wider polemic in his own time against apologists for papal temporal power, that a restoration of the Holy Roman Empire was necessary for the effective governance of the political sphere. Dante's belief in the dignity of man's nature and his polemical dualism may also help to explain his strange choice of Cato as the custodian of purgatory's shores in Purgatorio 1. Dante Pilgrim, facing south, initially sees four stars which represent allegorically the four cardinal virtues: prudence, justice, temperance, and courage, fortitude. Turning to face north, he sees these lights reflected, perfectly reflected, in the as yet unidentified pagan Cato. Why a pagan? Well, again, first of all, a pagan without access to the theological virtues, faith, hope, and charity, or to the Christian sacraments, may allegorically represent, in a way a Christian could not, the perfection of natural virtue. But why specifically the Roman pagan Cato, and why here in purgatory? Why is Cato not in Dante's special region of limbo allocated to the virtuous pagans? Why is he not even more appropriately in the wood of the suicides, in the circle of hell, reserved for those who did violence against themselves? St. Augustine specifically condemned Cato's suicide, and more generally, the vanity of pagan virtue. In stark contrast to this theological precedent, Dante reinterprets Cato's suicide as sacrifice and leaves no doubt about Cato's future glory at the resurrection of the body.
Or ti piacciar gradir la sua venuta, libertà va cercando, che essi cara commessa chi per lei vita rifiuta. Tu il sai che non ti fu per lei amare inutica la morte, ove lasciasti la vesta che al grandì sarà sì chiara.
Why does Dante adopt this apparently heretical position? The early commentaries write things like, quae videtur satere heresim. Why this choice and exaltation of the pagan Roman Cato? The fourth book of Dante's philosophical treatise, Il Convivio, serves as a helpful gloss. The book's subject is nobility, refuting contemporary definitions of nobility as residing in ancient wealth and pleasing manners. Dante defines nobility philosophically as the fulfillment or perfection of a being's nature. Following Aristotle, Dante argues that every living thing, each living thing, from a flower to a horse, has a certain natural perfection. This, he affirms, is its nobility. So you could talk of a noble horse. Human nobility, virtus vera nobilitas, is the perfection of man's rational nature. So it consists in virtue, which is practical activity in accordance with reason, and then in knowledge, the contemplative use of reason. That is that in which human nobility consists. Crucially, Cato Rutica for Dante exemplifies this human nobility. This is a quote. I'll read it in English for clarity. So the mention of his, Cato's name, is a happy note on which to end the required discussion of the signs of nobility, since in him, in Cato, nobility displays all these signs throughout every stage of life. In Purgatorio 1, Dante Pilgrim genuflects in deferential silence before Cato, who is described as worthy of more reverence than ever a son owed his father. Why specifically the pagan Cato? Because Cato embodies, for Dante, human nobility. Why this emphasis of the beginning of anti-purgatory? Because, I would argue, Cato's presence at the shore of Mount Purgatory differentiates the perfection of this secular goal from the very different goal, the recovery of Eden and the state of grace, represented by the ascent of purgatory. The four stars reflected in Cato in Purgatorio 1, the perfection of the cardinal virtues, are contradistinguished indeed by the three stars, allegorically representing the three theological virtues, which rise in their place and are cited by Dante Pilgrim in the last canto of Anti-Purgatory, Purgatorio 8. That's just before the gateway into purgatory proper and the ascent of the soul through the seven terraces to the earthly paradise. The startling presence of Cato thus throws into relief two distinct ethical goals. The first, a secular nobility achievable in this life through reason and the natural virtues, a goal attainable by pagans. The second, an eternal beatitude achievable only through grace and the revealed truth of Christ, and thereby seemingly unattainable by pagans. In the very first line of Paradiso 1, la gloria di colui che tutto muove, the glory of him who moves all things, Dante reaffirms the power of man's reason, and in this case, the power of reason to know God. God is not directly named in the canto. Rather, he is referred to by a series of philosophical definitions. Colui che tutto muove, he who moves all things. Quei che porte, he who is able. L'eterno valore, il quale è fine, al quale è fatta la toccata norma. The eternal work, the end to which is created, the order of the universe just touched upon. In principio loro, there, the different natures principle. Why this emphasis on classical definitions of God at the beginning of the Paradiso? Dante wrote a commentary on the opening of Paradiso 1 in his epistle to Can Grande, drawing explicitly on arguments taken from Aristotle's Metaphysics and the De Causis. Dante gives a lengthy exposition of three philosophical arguments for God summed up by these definitions. Dante's first argument leads to the definition of God as the first cause of existence, his second to God as the first cause of all particular essences, and his third, a version of the argument from movement or change, to God as the unmoved first mover. In Beatrice's speech in Paradiso 1, Dante translates these scholastic and technical arguments into the language of love. Change, the movement from potency to act, is understood as a form of love. Everything which is subject to change, from inanimate rocks to animate plants and animals, and to man, to humans as rational animals, is in potency to some goal which, because of its particular essence, it desires or loves. The principle, the ultimate cause of a being's essence, and the goal which that being, because of its essence, desires, is ordained by God. For this reason, God is also defined in Paradiso 1 as amor che il ciel governa. So I've added these two other definitions underneath the more strictly philosophical definitions. Amor che il ciel governi, love that governs the heavens. And in the last line of the poem, as l'amor che muove il sole e altre stelle. God is the ultimate cause of every being's essence, and each being in potency is directed, because of its particular essence, towards, it loves, it desires, its perfection, the actualization of this potency. Beatrice's long discourse on the order of the universe thus finally responds to Dante Pilgrim's key doubt in the canto. How can he, a bodily human being, rise up to paradise? Beatrice explains that although the essence of a particular thing is directed infallibly to its goal, like an arrow to its target, the matter in which each form is instantiated may, as imperfectly disposed, imperfectly receive the form, just as the form of a sphere is imperfectly carved by a sculptor. In the case of man, who has free will, he may be directed away from the fulfillment of his true nature because of false secondary goods. At the beginning of Inferno 1, Dante Pilgrim fails to climb the mountain because he is impeded by the three beasts. In Purgatorio 1, Dante Pilgrim searches for freedom from impedimento, libertà va cercando, which Cato, at a natural level, embodies. But with his human nature set free, Beatrice explains that it is now as natural for Dante to rise up to God as for a river to descend from a mountaintop to its base, and it would be as unnatural for him not to rise up as for a living fire to be motionless. Why pagan, classical philosophical arguments at the beginning of Paradiso? Because Dante seeks to emphasize that the essential form of man, naturally, when unimpeded by sin and ignorance, directs him to God as to his principal origin and end goal. The philosophical definitions of God and the discourse on the natural order of the universe in Paradiso 1 may also be understood, of course, as preparation for revelation, preambula fidei. Indeed, if we turn back to the illustration of Inferno 1, we can see that although Dante Pilgrim discovers Virgil, a pagan in the dark wood, Virgil himself is being directed, unbeknown to Dante, by Beatrice. And I think I'll close there and move on to speech. Thank you.
So the beautiful thing about these vertical readings is that you can take all different kinds of angles through, and I'm going to take a different approach here. In some ways you're visiting some the same moments that George has referred to, but in thinking it in a very different key. A structuring concept that runs through the ones is orientation. If we take orientation to mean the determination of the relative position of something or someone, we may note that each of these cantos stages a problem in the process of such determination. How does the pilgrim determine his position or locate his path? What point of reference does he choose? How does he relate to that point of reference? Finally, how do I, as a reader, relate to the particularity and the universality of the pilgrim as he seeks to orient himself at the threshold of three realms that are, by definition, foreign lands to us? By examining these issues of orientation, we may discover powerful means of exploring the relations and distinctions between the three canticles. These are, of course, distinctions not only between the realms the canticles reveal, but also between states of being in place. So let's begin with the very first lines. Nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita mi ritrovai per una selva oscura che la diritta via era smarrita. Halfway down the pathway of our life is a temporal indicator. Protagonist, as we know, is 35 years old and is referencing the scriptural expectation of a 70-year lifespan. But the imagery of the pathway suggests a spatial coordinate as well. He is halfway along his life's trajectory. The poet's exile means that his life's path is a literal one of peregrination, while it is, at the same time, the path of return to God. Even if we understand the cammin di nostra vita in strictly spiritual terms, there's no mistaking the fact that Dante will painstakingly map the twists and turns that his path will take from here onto very specific coordinates in the known world and at its margins. We readers are, at the same time, somewhat disoriented by the way in which the first line meets the second. Nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita mi ritrovai. So which path are we on? The path that all mankind takes through life? Or is this the single, individual, non-repeatable life of Dante Alighieri, Florentine, born in 1265? Is this timeline, this landscape, entirely symbolic and therefore pertinent to, if removed from all of us in its abstraction, or is it historically located in the year 1300? Are we reading autobiography? Are we reading theology? Are we reading as historians? Are we reading as mystics? As I take you swiftly through a series of depictions of spatial orientation in these three opening canti, we will see that in each of the three, moments of particular opacity, moments that have led to huge critical discussion and that have continued to perplex readers, hinge on the ways in which the specificity of place and the inscription of individual bodies into space push our understanding of the poem either toward historical realities or theological truths. Mi ritrovai, I found myself, the poet tells us, in a dark wood. What does it mean to find oneself in this case? He has, in this moment, recognized that he is in a dark wood and that he can no longer see the straight path. We don't know how long he has been there without noticing. He himself doesn't know, she points out. He has no idea how or where he entered. He has become conscious of his disorientation only now. It's only now that he looks around himself and sees where he is, already in the midst of the unknown. He has entered a wild, undomesticated space in which he can discern no point of reference. We can only assume that the pilgrim has of late neglected to examine his relation to the world around him. It takes considerable self-enclosure, significant abstraction, to stumble so far into the darkness that we can no longer see where we entered or locate any recognizable point. This is the condition of the sinners that are deepest in the Inferno, after all, figured elegantly in their contrapasso. Encased in ice, they have no means of exchange or relation with anything or anyone outside themselves. They have not understood that their place in the world must be a relative position. If we bear in mind this notion of the extremity of sin, the urgent focus on orientation in each of these three opening cantos becomes comprehensible. In each, the pilgrim has become sharply conscious of the ways in which he enters the realms that he enters, and of the signs that mark the paths that he takes. When the pilgrim comes to stand at the foot of a hill and sees the sun just above and behind it, it would seem that he has found his point of orientation, his guide, his way out of the darkness. But when he begins to climb, he is almost immediately driven back by the three beasts that block his way. It is at this moment, as we know, that the pilgrim meets Virgil. And Virgil is such a comforting presence, also because his opening speech lists a series of concrete, recognizable places, moving from the relatively local to the broader geography of the trajectory of Aeneas' voyage and Rome's founding. George already referred to this, I parenti miei fura Lombardi, Mantovani per patria ambedui, vissi a Roma, cantai di quel giusto figliuol d'Anchise che viene di Troia. The second major intersection of the poem, after that noi, me, of the first lines, is this moment in which a largely symbolic and eternal landscape, the wood, the hill, meets with a highly specific, grounded, and geographically and historically embedded Lombardy, Mantua, Rome, Troy. This is the challenge set to the reader, thinking history and human venture within the eternal, the individual within the collective, the local within the providential. And it is precisely in these moments that the most difficult hermeneutic problems appear. The first of the three I will discuss is Virgil's prophecy of the greyhound. Questi non ciberà terra né feltro, ma sapienza, amore e virtute, e sua nazione sarà tra feltro e feltro. So there have been myriad interpretations of that between felt and felt, including Dante's own astrological sign, the two mendicant orders, a technique of election, or to indicate geographical location, the towns of Feltre and Montefeltro. On a more general level, what exactly is the prophecy meant to indicate? Is this a specific known political leader who will do Italy some good? Or is this a secular redeemer who will make way for the second coming of Christ? Having it both ways is quite tricky here. Understanding the prophecy as referring to a distinct geographical location to designate the secular redeemer who will make way for the second coming of Christ commits Dante to a specificity that some might find problematic. If we interpret these statements in a purely allegorical key, we focus on the theological resonance of the poem's condemnation of sin and social ills and gloss over the felt problem. If we allow the little towns of Feltre and Montefeltro to delimit Dante's notion of the secular redeemer, we commit the poem to history, to a particular moment. We pin Dante's hopes to, say, Can Grande della Scala, a person who, as far as we can tell, did not restore order and prepare the way for the second coming. Leaving this mysterious prophecy dangling, Virgil then suggests a new system of orientation for the pilgrim. On Dio, per lo tuo, me penso e discerno, che tu mi segui, e io sarò tua guida, e trarò ti di qui per loco eterno. In other words, the pilgrim must orient himself in relation to Virgil, not in relation to geographical or universal coordinates. He must not follow the sun, but follow his own very personal guide. This pilgrimage will go from history into eternity, but by means of the vehicle of a still living mortal body. And there will be a return into history for that body. So from Dante's individual spot of disorientation to salvation, he'll be led by a guide that is of particular relevance to him personally, even as the source of his poetic style. But also one who is a narrator of Italy's providential history, of the finding as well as the founding of Italy. And so the pilgrim does follow Virgil through hell, often blindly, through that dark realm with increasing misery and claustrophobia as the only index of place, apart from the reassuring presence of his guide, to give structure to what the pilgrim and reader so viscerally experience. We're told at the end of the Inferno that the pair emerge to see the stars again, but the description only really properly arrives at the beginning of the Purgatorio, where the delight in perceiving external references of orientation is palpable and it's glorious. Dolce color d'oriental zaffiro, che s'accoglieva nel sereno aspetto del mezzo, puro infino al primo giro, agli occhi miei ricominciò di letto, tosto che io uscì fuor dell'aura morta, che m'avea contristati gli occhi e il petto. Dolce color d'oriental zaffiro. This is also the incredible pleasure of being in some way home, or at least above ground once again with a set of references that are recognizable. That's east. What follows is a deliriously joyful list of astronomical coordinates, a flourish of knowledge that shows the pilgrim back in relation with heavenly bodies. With his feet upon the earth, he knows something of his utterly new place due to his view of the heavens. Lo bel pianeta che da mar conforta faceva tutto rider d'oriente, velando I pesci che erano in sua scorta. I mi volsi a man destra e posi mente l'altro polo, e vidi quattro stelle non viste mai forte la prima gente. He doesn't need Virgil to tell him where he is now. He has seen it for himself. And this is the new mode of the Purgatorio. The pilgrim has no further need to blindly follow Virgil. He's encouraged to look around himself and to develop his own relational geographies, his own sets of coordinates, beginning with the heavens, but also within the landscapes and the human landscapes of the Purgatorio. His journey will be directed by his recognition of friends and countrymen who will serve to point the way upward, but also toward new understanding of vice and virtue. In Inferno, where there was only sin and no good to follow, the pilgrim was utterly dependent on his guide. Finding your way is a constant choosing of the good, as we come to understand in Purgatorio. And this option, this freedom, only at long last opens here. The assumption behind Cato's question reveals this Purgatorio difference. Chi va guidati? O che vi fu lucerna, uscendo fuor della profonda notte che sempre nera fa la valle inferna? In other words, the darkness of hell, symbolizing the totalizing blockage of the sinners enclosed within themselves and enclosed there, is such that it is impossible to navigate out of that place. Without a point of light, without stars or sun, there is no way to find your way out of hell. Only the right guide can save you. In Purgatorio, we find instead an alignment between astronomical and moral points of orientation, as becomes immediately clear when the pilgrim sees Cato. Vidi presso di me un veglio solo. Li raggi delle quattro luci sante pregiavan sì la sua faccia di lume, che chi vedea come il sol fosse davante. And this is, in fact, the second of the series of hermeneutical challenges I mentioned earlier. In some way, the way we resolve the challenge at the entrance of each realm is a kind of test for us as readers. Our resolution will in some way determine our reading of the entire canticle to follow. And each canticle of the comedy must be read in a different key, employing different tools. There has been much ink spilled over the problem of the reality of these four stars. Yes, they stand for the cardinal virtues, as George already mentioned, prudence, justice, fortitude, temperance. But the dense context of reference to Venus, to Pisces, etc., indicate that Dante also wishes us to understand them as literal stars, also as natural phenomena. They are points of orientation in a part of the world as yet unknown to us, and they point directly to Cato, a historical person whose concrete life is taken here, in this place, as emblematic of moral virtue. His presence as momentary guide, and there will be many of these in Purgatorio, while there was really only Virgil in Inferno, is a perfect alignment of celestial, moral, and human reference. Cato's presence is another immense challenge to the reader, one to which George has already alluded. What do we do with the life of the historical Cato, a pagan, a republican, a suicide? How do we understand the place of that historical specificity within the text? Well, Purgatorio is of the earth, and its points of orientation are, as we see in the example of the stars that Dante notes, partly recognizable and partly entirely new. We may use some of our earthly coordinates to navigate here, but some should be left behind as we look toward other new markers of place and of identity. The poet stages a little faux pas on Virgil's part that helps the reader process the challenge of orientation posed by the intersection of our knowledge of the historical Cato and the beplumed guardian before us, and gives us a sense of the new coordinates and the new horizons of this realm. Virgil refers back to Cato's suicide, giving the name of the place in an assertion of and recollection of historical geographies, and appeals for help in the name of Marcia, Cato's wife, who now inhabits Limbo. Cato's chilly rebuke redraws geographical boundaries and sets new points of reference. Marzia piacque tanto agli occhi miei, mentre chi fu di là, disse egli allora, che quante grazie fosse da me, te. Ora che di là dal mal fiume dimora, più muover non mi può, per quella legge che fatta fu quando me ne uscì fora. Cato does not respond to Virgil's evocation of place. Such places are no longer relevant to him. The only coordinate that matters is the boundary line of the mal fiume, dividing the saved from the damned. Now that Marcia is beyond that line, she can do no more to move him. She is certainly not forgotten, but she, as well as other aspects of Cato's personal history, has been reframed by a broader vision with added and more compelling points of reference. For the pilgrim, the reorientation needed here constitutes something of a return. As in the first canto of the Inferno, Dante must retrace his steps, going back down before he can ascend the mountain. Cato tells him, Lo sol vi mostrerà che surge ormai prendere il monte più leve salita. In other words, as he begins again, the pilgrim must follow the lead of the sun. With Virgil at his side rather than leading him, he will once again take up the challenge that defeated him in the first canto of the Inferno. He will ascend a mountain, not just a hill this time, but it's clear that the poet does mean for us to make connections between the colle of Inferno 1 and the monte of Purgatorio 1, taking the sun as his guide. In Paradiso, the issue of orientation is again utterly different. We are no longer on earth, there's no more landscape, and as in hell, we are in an eternal space. If it's difficult to navigate hell because of the absence of celestial markers, difficult to navigate earth and Purgatorio because of things that impede our adherence to what may be a perfectly clearly marked path, such as forests, beasts, tiredness, the need for sleep, etc., it would be a challenge to navigate Paradiso because of the sheer proximity of the stars. In Purgatorio, the coordinates of place are also the all-important coordinates of time. The sun, stars, recognizable constellations, and planets all join in a choreography that maps the pilgrim's progress through space and time. But it is distance from these heavenly bodies that constitutes their relative meaning. To be in Paradiso is to be immersed in the simultaneity and blinding light of the heavenly spheres, in the place where all of historical time is seen as one indivisible moment. Fortunately, there's no real need to navigate in Paradiso, and we must first of all relinquish our sense of needing to find our own way in order to understand what it means to enter into this realm. But how does the individual historical human fit at all, or even just be in his or her place, in a realm without coordinates? The third of these particular challenges to the reader in terms of conceptualizing the relationship between body and place occurs here.
Surge ai mortali per diverse foci la lucerna del mondo, ma da quella che quattro cerchi giugne con tre croci, con miglior corso e con migliore stella, esce congiunta, e la mondana cera più a suo modo tempera e suggella.
How are we to understand the place that Dante designates as four circles joined with three crosses? There has been considerable debate upon this point. What does seem clear is that in this detailed description of the sun's point of entrance, there is a very specific reference to a certain point in time that references both the creation and the resurrection. At this locus of astronomical circles and crosses, the poet stages an intersection between the pilgrim's voyage that takes place in time, in Easter week of 1300, and the eternal realm into which he here enters. The pilgrim rises to Paradiso in the time of Christ's resurrection, or when Christ's historical being is transformed into eternal being, and also in the time in which creation was thought to occur, or when the eternal made space for historical time. In a parallel way, the historical individual that is Dante Alighieri enters into the eternal space that is Paradiso with his body, or at least that's how I understand it, because this is the second fold of the interpretive crux that we run up against in the opening of the Paradiso. So first, can those four celestial circles be joined with three crosses, or is this merely an allegorical vision of the four cardinal virtues meeting the three theological virtues? Well, that will depend on your mappings and understandings of ecliptics and equinoxes and so forth. But this problem as to whether Dante can be referencing real astronomical phenomena and whether he was doing so accurately, or even intends to do so accurately, is paired with a major theological issue. The second fold, does Dante really mean for us to believe that he ascends to Paradiso in body? Echoing Paul, he says,
Si era sol di me quello che assi, dove la mente, amor che ciel governi, tu sai che col tuo lume mi levasti.
But it is precisely the pilgrim's confusion that follows soon after these lines that suggests that he is, in fact, there in body. Once again, as in the first canto of the Inferno, he's entirely disoriented, as his human senses perceive something beyond their purview. A human body that depends on orientation to understand its place has entered into the coordinates of orientation themselves. I don't have this one here, sorry about that.
Parvemi tanto allor del cielo acceso, della fiamma del sol, che pioggia o fiume, lago non fece alcun tanto disteso.
So this is where he sees this incredible light and doesn't understand what he's looking at. And Beatrice explains,
Tu non sei in terra, sì come tu credi, ma folgore, fuggendo proprio sito, non corse come tu cadesso riedi.
The pilgrim's confusion of place is such that he has not recognized that he is no longer on earth. But this time, his disorientation is entirely unproblematic. movement here needs no guide. But he continues to need to orient himself, and this for the reader is great mercy. It is the particularity of the pilgrim, his human, corporeal historicity, that provides him with an end with the mode of we're just going to take questions, comments. We want to hear your ideas about the vertical readings of the ones. We're going to do questions for about 15 minutes, I think. 10 minutes even. If you have other engagements and need to leave now, we perfectly understand. But we do hope you'll give us some comments. Thank you.